Right? But it's nice to see all of you.
Good to see you also.
Let's go yumtif. Today is a special day. And more Emily, we got to see some projects for the special day today. Today's Hey Teves, the 5th of Tevet, and it's a real yumtif for our generation specifically. It's not something that we're celebrating from history, even though everything that we celebrate from history, it really pertains to our life and teaches us what Judaism's about and keeping it strong. But this is a nowadays celebration. And it actually pertains to the previous Rebbe's library. So I'll give you a quick history so you get what the celebration is, and then we'll learn what the significance of the celebration is and how we should celebrate and how we can take something practically for our lives to enlighten our home and strengthen our Judaism. So the previous Rebbe, when he was in back in the Soviet Union, the way it's written is that he noticed, or whatever, however you want to say it, he noticed that all establishments had libraries. And he said Judaism is the real establishment. Jewish people as a whole are the real establishment. And I guess in those days it was represented by a library. So he was going to make a Jewish library. And obviously, as Jewish people, a library doesn't just signify that, the Russian government had a library, and so we should also. But we know that the library of Jewish books, you can see behind me a little bit of ours, but it's definitely not as big as the previous Rebbe's. A library of Jewish books is full with the Torah in many different versions, the history, the mitzvot, the learning, the revealed the Torah, the deeper meanings and the significance and of the Torah and the mitzvot, all that is really, it is our establishment. That is who we are. That is what we live from. And that is what keeps Judaism, keeps Jewish people together throughout all the ages, how Jewish people survived so much. So much persecution was through the Torah and through following what are in our books. We live our life based on them, regular day-to-day life, but it's all based and imbued with what those books teach. And so this was the significance of the Friedrich Rebbe's library, the previous Rebbe. He worked extremely hard to collect every last Jewish book that he can find. And in those days, I'm sure a lot of you know better than I do, but it's not like we have nowadays where there's books being printed, 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 printed. Every book was a treasure. And the Friedrich Rebbe wrote letters to people in all different communities around the world saying, if you have a Jewish book, send it. We're making a Jewish library. And when he gathered many, 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 a great collection of treasures, and many of them are books that were owned by very great people, including the Baal Shem Tov and many others. One of the books in this library is the Siddur from the Baal Shem Tov, which is, about 300 years ago, the one who really started Hasidut, and many others that are just the only copy that exists nowadays of Jewish books that were printed ages back. And when he was leaving Soviet Union, first they were miraculously letting him out. And then on the way out, they were trying to make one last little problems before he can leave, and they told him that he can't leave with his library. And the Rebbe describes in one of his talks, and I actually just watched the video with my kids today, by supper. We tried having a little bit of a of a farbringen, of a watching the Rebbe's video and giving each other brachot and telling them what the day is. And we were watching the video, and the Rebbe says there that every day that the previous Rebbe would stay in, which city was it at that time? I can't remember one of the cities. It wasn't the capital. It was on his journey out of the Soviet Union. Every day that he stayed there longer was literally a risk to his life. But he knew that they were fighting him and they were fighting Judaism, and we can't let people fight Judaism by not letting him take his books. And he said, I'm staying here with my family. I'm leaving with my family with the entire library. And they ended up helping him take the library, and he took it with him out of the Soviet Union to Riga, where he went next, and to the next places afterwards. Later on, when he was escaping the Holocaust, lots of it was left behind, and later, again, worked with a lot of hard effort, retrieved and brought to 770 to the previous Rebbe's shul. And in the basement of 770, there are many, 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 many shelves that house this library. Some about 45 years later, after the previous Rebbe arrived in the States, there was a family member who claimed to be an heir, I don't know which one is Canadian and which one's South African. My mother's South African, so I don't know if you're meant to pronounce the H or not. But you're not an heir. Okay, so claimed to be an heir and was wanting to sell the books and make a profit, and indeed started taking them without getting full permission. And it ended up in Supreme Court, where the Rebbe's stance was that the previous Rebbe was not a regular person who passed away and now his belongings move on to his descendants. Rather, the Friedrich Rebbe is still alive. His movement is alive. The Rebbe is the one leading his life. The Rebbe is continuing his work. And the Friedrich Rebbe's work didn't cease for a moment, and it's only growing, and the Judaism that's flourishing around the world, and the steps that we're taking closer to come to the ultimate Judaism being everywhere with all Jews and all mitzvot in our holy land with Mashiach, we're only growing and growing in that work. And the fact that the previous Rebbe's life was his work. He himself, it was not a person who now his belongings go to his inheritance. He himself belongs to the Jewish people, as well as all his possessions that were only used for the Jewish people, still belong to the Jewish people and to the Rebbe who's leading them, leading us, all of us, in the same work that the Friedrich Rebbe, we see it continuing now. We see this in actually the Rebbe and his wife, the Rebbetzin, never actually went to court. They were represented, and many, many of the Hasidim would travel there every day to be present and be a presence in the courtroom. But they did come to get testimony. And the Rebbe was closely involved, obviously, in the details of what's gonna explain this. The judge ended up needing to understand what is the value of a Rebbe. What does it mean to be a real Jewish leader that is only here for the Jewish people and for the work that he's doing and in spreading Judaism and helping Jews and everyone around the world? And they got a testimony from the previous Rebbe's daughter, the Rebbe's wife, where she said that after an interview, they asked her, so do the books belong to your father or do they belong to the Hasidim? Do they belong to the people that are using them now? And she said, my father and the books belong to the Hasidim. And this was one of the things that really showed the judge clearly that this is not a regular man. This is Judaism. This is the head of Judaism that's continuing and alive, and it's not a regular inheritance. And the Rebbe explained throughout this ordeal that the Supreme Court case was just a personification of a heavenly court case, saying that the Rebbe is not doing enough. And that he's not doing what he's meant to be doing. Just, you know, there's always the good side and the bad side. And the bad side in the heavenly court was trying to make some trouble. But with the victory, we see the victory of the Rebbe and the victory of the work that the Rebbe has. And the same way we have a practical victory that the court ruled that the entire library belongs to the Rebbe and the Hasidim and to the Jewish people as a whole, not as an individual of the previous Rebbe, as an individual person. The Rebbe says that this is really a victory of Judaism and the spreading of Judaism, and a victory in our continued work in taking leaps and bounds towards Mashiach and more Judaism being all over the world with all of us. And that's why we're here today, continuing to learn and to grow. And so it's really our victory. It's our victory of our personal Judaism. And we all know what we gain from the Rebbe. The fact that we're learning here today is from the Rebbe. And all that is because of the Rebbe's victory. Because of the Rebbe's victory in that he's going to continue leading us to have a real understanding of Judaism and be connected to Hashem and bring Mashiach. So that's a little bit history of why it's a celebration and what the significance is. Practically, by the first anniversary of, or perhaps it was the second anniversary of celebrating this victory, there we give a new and practical way to celebrate.
I will claim after.
And the Rebbe said that he is going to give out to whoever's present and whoever would like $2, and one will be for tzedakah. Like I'm sure many of you know, the Rebbe many times gave dollars so that people should give them to charity, to tzedakah, so that they should be a messenger of doing a mitzvah. The Rebbe is going to make them his messenger to do the mitzvah of tzedakah. And many people obviously most people would switch that dollar, keep the one that they got from the Rebbe's hands and give another dollar to tzedakah. So the Rebbe said, like usual, I'm going to give $1, but I'm also going to give a second dollar. And this one isn't for tzedakah. This one is so that you should go and spend the money, because today, this is the Rebbe saying this on the anniversary, because today is connected to holy books, spend this dollar in contribution towards buying new holy books or mending old holy books. A very practical, down-to-earth way of celebrating a victory of books, of Jewish books. And I want to share a little bit about that in my personal life, from what the Rebbe said, and from what we can take for ourselves and for our children and grandchildren. So there's been a study, actually. You know, I'll tell you the study in a second. I can show you behind here our little library. I'll show you a little bit. Let's see if I can take the computer with me. Is it gonna die? No, I have a few minutes. Okay, can you see it? Okay, so this is our library. It's actually half of our books. the other half is still in boxes waiting for IKEA's Billy shelves to come back into stock with the COVID crisis. So for me, this is right across the doorway of our house. This is the warmth in my house. And when I walk in, I wanted to place them right across the door, because what this feels for me is a warmth of Judaism in my home. And it's not just me that feels this way. It's actually one of 10 campaigns that the Rebbe led, mitzvah campaigns. One of them being tefillin, which I'm sure you've heard, is, or some of you have heard, that the Rebbe had a campaign that people, men and boys over the age of 13, should put on tefillin. And another one of them being that women and girls shall light candles before Shabbos and before Yom Tov. Another being mezuzah, another being love of your fellow Jew. Basic mitzvot that were campaigns to spread Judaism to as many Jews to do these mitzvot. One of them, just out of 10, and there are 613 mitzvot, so the Rebbe chose 10 that he wants to be spread in a campaign, like to go to as many Jews as possible. One of them is called Bayis Male Sfarim, or Bayit Male Sfarim. And that means in English to have a house full of holy books. And the Rebbe described that this is a mitzvah. It's not an actual commandment to have a house full of Sfarim, but it's a good deed that is a reminder for all other good deeds. And I definitely feel that in my house, having a wall full of Sfarim is just gives that feeling to want to do mitzvot, to want to be involved in Judaism, to love Judaism. And now I'll tell you the study. So the reason why I'm telling you the study second is because sometimes people like to learn something from a secular source, and then when they see it in the Torah, they say, oh, Torah says that too? And it's nice, like the secular is true, and oh, Torah also says that. But really the truth is the opposite, that whatever Torah says is 100% true. And it's nice when we see a secular source that agrees and that is in line with the Torah. So that's why I'm saying it second. But there was a study, you can see the numbers, I have it written here. My husband told me about it and I looked it up. So the US Department of Education did a study on about 20,000 students in the US from age kindergarten to fifth grade. And they had the parents of the children interviewed and did a questionnaire of many questions, and they gained a lot of information from it that is very insightful to what is the real building blocks of parenting, and what's really the building blocks that encourage children to do well. You know, because many parents will say they need to learn more. But this study didn't actually show those results. So it's one of the conclusions, because obviously it had many questions, but one of the conclusions from the study was that a child who had 50 books in their home did 5 points well, 5 points better than a child who had no books in their home. And this is a study of 20,000 children. And then again, a child who had 100 books in their home did an additional 5 points better than the children who had 50 books. And you know, you would think it's because they have so many books. They probably learn them. They probably read them. Their parents probably make them read them, right? we're talking about young children. And that wasn't the results of the study. The results of the study were that the mere having those books on the shelves was a tactic in education for the children to learn to gain subconsciously the value of studying. Now, this is a secular source of non-Jewish, not necessarily, maybe there were some Jewish children as well, but not necessarily Jewish children, and non-Jewish books on shelves. Now, imagine the value, and that's why I started off with describing that I can actually feel this in my home, and I'm really appreciative to my parents, which I'll tell you soon, how they imbued this value in me, and they really took the Rebbe's campaign into our own home. Imagine just in our minds, if secular books, math, history, science and the like, can have an influence on a student's actual outcome of grades because of the value that it shows them in learning. Imagine the value that we can give ourselves, not just, but definitely our children and grandchildren, the value of Judaism that's in holy books. And it's just being in the house has a subconscious, it might also have some conscious effects, but it definitely has a subconscious effect on the values that the children and the way we feel, what we absorb from our physical surroundings. So we're talking about absorbing the values of learning, of wanting to learn about Judaism, of caring to know what's in those books. When my kids see these books, it's like, does Tati learn all of these? You know, like curiosity, what's in all these books. And definitely more, the fact that it's holy, it's imbuing, and it's in the room, it's in the surroundings, it's imbuing holiness and a sensitivity to appreciate holiness that are just through our breathing and seeing on a constant basis the environment of holy books. The Rebbe actually said this in many occasions, in many different ways, that how much an atmosphere of holiness can affect us in ways that we don't even realize how much they're effective. And one of the things is from very young, from when women are expecting, the Rebbe goes into detail of things that can help a fetus gain the value and the sensitivity to holiness, starting from looking at only kosher animals, for the mother to look at only kosher animals, and hearing Jewish music, learning extra, doing extra mitzvot while we're expecting, and doing those things surround the fetus with those values from before they're born. And then as soon as we're born, one of the things that the Rebbe was very adamant is that a mother should take to the birthing room a card that has, it's called the Shir HaMalis card. And it has prayers on it. And obviously with Hebrew letters, which even Hebrew letters are holy letters. They're not just any language. And many times people get the card with the picture of the Rebbe on the other side. That as soon as the child's born, we should have the Shir HaMalis near the baby, so that right away he or she is being, I said he because I have three boys, but right away the child is being surrounded by holiness. And we can't imagine the effect that it can have on the sensitivity and appreciation that the child grows up with towards Judaism and towards holiness and to Hashem and to doing mitzvot. And so having a house full of Sefarim, which is specifically holy books and Jewish books, is a concrete way that we can, you know, before we start pressuring our children to learn this and do well in Hebrew school and do well in your Judaics class or anything of that sort, a basic thing, practical, that we can do with that has only positivity involved, no pressure involved, is just buying books and keeping them around the house. Around the house or on the shelves. And I'll show you I'll highlight some of the things in my library soon, but I'll first tell you a little bit about how my parents taught me to appreciate having a library, and obviously everything that comes along having a Jewish library, like we described, the appreciation for Judaism and for holiness. So we're coming from Hanukkah, and one of the customs on Hanukkah, a very prominent custom, not a mitzvah, because the mitzvah is to light the menorah, but the custom is to give Hanukkah gelt. Not necessarily gifts, but the original version of the custom is to give money. And it's called Hanukkah gelt in Yiddish. And one of the purposes of Hanukkah gelt, there are many explanations and reasonings for the custom. One of them is for the chinuch, for the education of the children. In particular, one of the ways the Rebbe actually explains that it can be for chinuch is to teach the children how to give tzedakah with money that you earn. So when we earn money, we're supposed to give at least 10%, up to 20% of our earnings to tzedakah, to a charity that is providing something good to anybody who needs it. And when we give our children money, we have the opportunity to teach them what we're supposed to do with money. And we don't wait till they grow up and start having their own money and decide what they want to buy with it. We can guide them to, you know, mommy and tati gave you money now. Here's how you can use it. Firstly, we have to give tzedakah, because when we get money, it doesn't all belong to us. It's from Hashem, and we have to give some of it to tzedakah. So, and then the rest of it, you can use how you wish. So my parents, particularly my father, I noticed over the years, would always give us Hanukkah gelt that would actually make us happy. It wasn't just dimes and quarters. We actually felt like we received an allowance, like we received something that was substantial for whatever age we were, if it was enough to buy an actual treat or whatever it was, something substantial, not just a few pennies. And we knew very clearly, maybe my father told us, I don't know if he said it straight out or if for sure later on he did, but we knew that we were getting more Hanukkah gelt than some of the rest of our friends, because we were supposed to use them after we give tzedakah. We were supposed to use it for when Hey Tavis comes around, which is today, just 3 days after Hanukkah. And like I mentioned, that where the Rebbe says that the Rebbe gave everyone money to go use to buy holy books. The Rebbe said, my father would say that Hey Tavis is right after Hanukkah, and we're giving you Hanukkah gelt so that you can use your money to buy your own Jewish books that you'll own. They'll be yours. It doesn't belong to the family on the shelf. These belong to you because you're buying them with your own money. And every year we would make a trip to the Judaica store. And now in Calgary, it means either coming to Chabad to buy something or going online. There's many, many online websites where you can order things that will, you know, take a few weeks and it'll be by your door. And we would go to the Judaica store and choose the Jewish books we want. Sometimes we left with stories of tzaddikim, of righteous people, just Jewish stories. Sometimes we left with books that we know we knew the title, even though we couldn't learn them until 10 years later because we wouldn't understand them. Or more than 10 years later, depending on how old you are, were. And sometimes, we left with kids' books. If I don't remember necessarily doing this, I don't remember actually buying my own kids' books. My memories are from buying like second grade level books since then. But I do remember taking my younger siblings and buying them an actual Jewish kids' book. To buying actual holy books. And a few things were accomplished here. And looking back, it was definitely an education tactic that proved successful. Where number one, we were given the money, and that the value of money is for Judaism. So that's what we learned was, what's worthwhile buying. At the same time, we also learned the value of Jewish books. And I grew up, and I still till today have a passion to just have as many Jewish books as I can have. And there's two aspects to having so many Jewish books. We spoke about just the atmosphere that it creates, and obviously it's also so that hopefully we'll get to one book at a time and actually learn them. But the Rebbe clearly spoke that even if they just sit on the shelf, like we said, it has an effect. But we can make commitments to, I think it's impossible for me to learn all these books in my lifetime. But I do hope to get to one at a time. And I appreciate the value of having them on my shelves. So I'll show you a little bit. I'll show you a little bit how we set this up. If you can see, we have is this a good camera view? We have some sets and some sections. So at the top is a row of 60, a set of 60 that is of just the Rebbe's talks, just our Rebbe's talks. In addition to that, we have here on, can you see here? This is another set of the Rebbe's talks. And here is a set of the Rebbe's letters to people. And you see a bunch of my letters to the Rebbe that we keep in there until we could bring them to the aisle, to the Rebbe's aisle. And then here we have some commonly used books like Benching After the Meal and all the little ones that we let the kids touch. we have a bunch of regular chumashim that actually have the five books of Moses in different versions, and random ones of the Tanya, and underneath that, that's actually a set that I got when I was about 10 years old. I got as a gift of the previous Rebbe's talks. And then up here we have all our English ones. Not all of them, but the ones that we have out of the boxes. So we have in the middle English sets, and they range from learning to stories. Jewish law and English at the bottom. One thing that I can highlight, for example, is this is a book that I really appreciate. It's called GPS for a Happier Marriage, and it's a Jewish perspective on marriage. There is, one hand while I'm holding the computer. There's books about Rebbe's letters on health and mental health here. Here are some stories. This one actually, I know we for sure have in Chabad. It's called My Story, People's Encounters of Their Experiences with the Rebbe. the second volume to it right here. Let's see if we can get that back in. There's letters in English. There's more of them, but I don't know them all. I have just these three. I actually do have this one here. I'll show you what's inside. I'll put the laptop down so I can show you what's inside. So I only found this when I was getting married and I was going through my house finding my things that belonged to me. I was going through my parents' house and I went through the many shelves. We have about at least 17 bookshelves together with what my parents own and what each of the children bought over the years. And I found this one. I said, oh, it looks like it belongs to me because look what's inside. This is a picture of myself and my cousin there. And if you look at the hat, I think it's my, I think it was my third birthday or second birthday. Does it say in it? I think it had a note too. I can't remember. I remember having a note. But I think it's my second or third birthday, and I obviously got this as a birthday present. So you can see again how we were taught from young that a present is a Jewish book and that it's exciting. And that's a picture of me receiving it. And I guess my mother put it in the book, which is a good way for me to know that it belonged to me 15 years later or more. And since then, I started reading it. I'm about a third way through with a learning partner, and it's really enjoyable. And it's letters from the Rebbe on different topics of perspective on life and troubleshooting our feelings and our commitment to Judaism. And that's just one thing I got when I was young. Another thing in our library here, my husband insisted. I didn't really understand exactly why at first, but he insisted that my notes for my Judaics classes in high school and seminary belong in our library. So here's one of my binders. And here are a few more of my binders. Not everything. I have a bunch more from high school that didn't fit on the shelves, but that is part of our Jewish library of Jewish learning. So even though it's an active library, even though I haven't learned nearly a tenth of these books at all, but as long as we're active with some of them, the library's active. One thing I did get from books. One thing I did get through is this shelf, which is our shelf of English stories of righteous people, and I don't think there's one of them that I didn't read yet. But that's one of them. And then there's Jewish law on the bottom. There's actually a lot of Jewish law in very clear English. We have one I can show you. Here, this one's clear English about the laws of Shabbat. And there's many other here, many others. And there's here books about the laws and customs of the Jewish home. And there's definitely, where's the one that my mother gave me? There's one English one that my mother gave me when I got married. I'm trying to see where it is. I can't find it, but it's about the beauty of mikveh, and that's in English as well. So there's, they come in many shapes and colors and languages. I actually did get some compliments from even like nanny interviews that were like, it's so beautiful, all the gold lettering. It definitely is a prize. And the meaning of the campaign with the way the Rebbe coined it is very accurate. The Rebbe calls it Bayis Malei Sfarim, a home full of Jewish books. And the word full means that there is no place that isn't impermeated with it. If your cup is full, there's no space in the cup that doesn't have water. And if a home is full of Sfarim, that means two things. It means that there is as many Sfarim as you can have. So there's always room to get more Jewish books. And, you know, every year buy another one, add to your library, learn more, or get them even if you won't learn them. Because like we said, it gives that feeling that we can't get in another way, of just being surrounded by Judaism. And it also means that that's the point. The point of the Jewish books in the home is that it is full and it is, fills the house. It fills every fiber of the people living in the home. And it fills us with that feeling for appreciating Judaism and appreciating what the books say and teach. And that's the Torah and the mitzvot. So that's what I wanted to share with you today. It's actually in this week's Parshas Vayeshev. And I don't know, did my mother-in-law teach you what last week's Parsha is about Yosef coming down to Egypt? Did she speak about that at all? So in this week's Parsha, Yosef actually brings his father and family back down to Egypt. And as they're traveling, Yaakov sends his son, Yehuda, one of the 12 tribes, and he sends him ahead of the rest of the family. And he says, go down to Egypt. And before we get there, start a yeshiva, start a Jewish school. And the Rebbe teaches that the significance of this is that no matter where Jews are, they were going into an exiled country. They were leaving the Holy Land, going down to Egypt, because that's where they had safety and food, because that's where Yosef was. And he was bringing them down to out of famine. But they, wherever Jews go, the Jewish books, the learning, and the Torah is what holds us up and helps us persevere whatever challenges come and bumps come our way. And it's very significant that it comes out that this week's Parsha Vayeshev, where we see the significance of learning Torah, where Yaakov sent his son ahead to prepare the learning center before they got there, that it falls out on the week where Heteves is, where we celebrate the victory of the books, where we celebrate the victory of Judaism that is personified by the Jewish books. And there's definitely much out there that can be bought. It's endless. And when you start getting a taste for it, you'll see that you'll want more and more. So if any of you would like to start tonight and celebrate the Judaism that we all live with, and to sell and to add in that Judaism and actually purchase a book or two or three, then you can let me know. I'll actually tell you a website you can go to that is a Canadian website, so it's easier to get. What was it? Let me see.
Would you please share the link in the chat?
Yeah, that's a good idea. Let me see. I'm gonna ask my husband. Miss Lady, what's the site? The Canadian one. I'll start putting it in. I should start putting it in Google, you mean? Here. This morning, it was very cute, but I'm trying to emulate my father. I see gula.ca. That makes sense? Gula supplies. Yeah. Just gula.ca. Okay. I'm trying to emulate my parents and do the same for my kids. And I know obviously that it's educating myself as well. It's not just educating my kids, but the passion in owning and displaying in my home and using in my home Jewish books is educating myself in Judaism. But I'm trying to give it to my kids as well. So we did give them, a few loonies every night, and we told them at the end to count it up and to give tzedakah from it first. So we counted 10%. You know, they can't do the math perfectly, but I mean, not at all, but we display that we're doing the math of 10%, and we put it aside in the tzedakah box. And then we went on the website and chose for them, 20 options that we thought were, it's hard for, if I would take them to a real life store, it'd be easier for them to just look around and see what they're excited about. But we chose for them, about 20 things that are pertinent for their age. Some things that are, like I told you, things that I got that I wouldn't learn for another 15 years. So we showed them some of those, like the Tanyam. My son chose, we told them to choose one, like safer, one holy book that he can't necessarily understand and read now, and one children's book, and one music book of Jewish songs. They have like with buttons that play Jewish songs with like pages explaining the songs. So my son actually chose, my son actually chose this one, and he barely knows what it is, but he chose, he chose this one right here. It has a little pet on it. It's a book of the Rebbe's talks. It has 39 volumes. I can tell you there's 60 up there, and there was another hole on the other side, but there's more. The Rebbe taught us a lot, and the Rebbe is leading us a lot. So this is a volume of 39, and we told him he can choose the one that has the Aleph or the Bet, the first volume or the second volume, and he chose the Bet. So he wants to get the Rebbe's talks with the Bet on it. And then he chose also a children's book. So let me put in the chat here. There we go. That's the website where you can choose. They have many wonderful things. If you want advice of something to start with, you can definitely message me or my mother-in-law to give you ideas. That's my number. And we can help you out, choose something that's something you'd appreciate to own and to learn. But you can also just choose anything, because anything in the home that's a Jewish book will give that feeling that we can't get in another way for yourselves and for your children and grandchildren. If anyone has any questions, you can ask.
Thank you so much, Mushka. It's such a wonderful, wonderful class. And I love the book. And I actually wanted to have a suggestion. I've been dreaming for years, especially after going to the Jewish retreat, and they have displays of books and books, and I was bringing home a full suitcase of them. If we could have a book fair, bring those books and have a book fair like that.
That would be amazing. That would be amazing. We do have many in Chabad. We have a very big library in Chabad, and there's also a place to start if you find a book. Actually, in camp, it was really nice. This past summer, we started a new form of electives. We called it Electives Fair. And the idea is that kids should be able to be themselves and be their own explorers and do something that they enjoy. So we put out 30 activities across the shul, which is the lunchroom and camp, and outdoors in the play area, from sports to crafts to just Play-Doh to whatever they can try. And we let them explore. And there was one girl who was sitting on the side, and I asked her, like, can I help you choose something? And she said, no, I don't like anything. And I told her, there has to be something that you like. There are lots of activities here. And so I asked her a few things. Do you like this? Do you like that? Do you like that? And she said, no, I don't like this. No, I don't like that. No, I don't like that. And then, I don't know, the idea just popped into my head. I said, do you like reading? And she said, I love reading. So I said, well, then we have a huge library of Jewish books. Come read something. So she, and on the way, I started asking her, I said, what do you like reading? Do you like novels? Do you like short stories? Do you like, and she's like, actually, this is going to be weird because I know I'm just 10, but I like reading about law. So I said, well, we have lots of shelves about Jewish law. Come choose one. So I took her to the shelf. Well, in Chabad, there's way more than I can show you here. But I took her to the shelf, and she looked through them, paged through them. And she actually chose this one. We have it in Chabad as well. It's random laws, because there's so many laws in Judaism. It's called Halachot of Kizayit. And what it really is the laws of making a blessing on a food, and then the after blessing, after you finish eating. So there's laws of how much you need to eat in order to qualify for an after blessing. And you need it, the amount is that you need to eat what's called a kezias, the size of an olive, an ancient size of an olive, which is about the size of a nowadays egg. And there's many laws pertaining different types of food, if it goes according to volume or weight, and which foods, how much you need to eat of specific foods. Like, there's pictures of how many Cheerios you need to eat in order to qualify for an after blessing, and how much sponge cake you need to eat to qualify for an after blessing. Wow. And she went through that. So that was from our Jewish library in Chabad. So hopefully one day we'll do that, Eugenia. That would be really, really nice. And meanwhile, we can definitely come to Chabad and choose something, and then we can order them.
That will be amazing.
Yeah. But do take upon yourself something that you'll do going in the direction of acquiring Jewish books and displaying them in your home and adding to that Jewish atmosphere and that feeling of holiness. That sensitivity to holiness that it gives. If there's any other questions, I'll try answer. Okay, thank you so much, everybody. Usually when I join, it's like while I'm cooking for Shabbos. So I don't get to see all of you, but it's nice to see you this time, and I hope we'll see you again.
Thank you, Mushka.
Great job, us. My pleasure.
Tudah rabah. Medaberet Ivrit or no?
A little bit. Okay. Be well. Good job, us.
All the best. Good job, us.